Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Abhinav, and recently the UPSC CMS exam has been done already, and I hope everyone has given their best, and we'll wait for the results to know what the exam holds for us. So meanwhile, what I thought is that we'll try to solve the questions that which we attended this past weekend. So due to time restrictions, I couldn't solve every subject. So what I have done is I've just solved the surgery subject. So, and we'll discuss about the surgery subject now. So, and I've also started a Telegram group where you can add your answers so that quickly we can solve the other subjects also. So, your help is needed here. So, join the channel and let's solve the questions together there. So, this surgery topics, mostly the answers were from Bailey and Love. And for a few answers, I have referred the Marrow notes also. So if there is any mistake, please do let me know in the comment section so that no one gets misguided. So before solving, remember to join our Telegram channel and also our other channels. So don't forget to subscribe. So let's solve the surgery questions now. So the first question was, which of the following are types of wound healing? So primary intention, secondary intention, tertiary intention, quaternary intention. We all know that primary intention is putting the suture. So secondary intention is not closing the wound, just leaving it to heal by itself. And tertiary intention is delayed primary intention. So there's nothing called as quaternary intention. So the types of wound healing, the answer is 1, 2, and 3. A 50-year-old female presents to the emergency with pain, swelling, and redness over the left foot following a trivial trauma 3 days back. On examination, the swelling over the left foot is poorly localized. Local tenderness and erythema are present. Crepitus is absent. Distal pulsations are palpable. Most likely clinical diagnosis is. So here we can rule out fasciitis because there is no crepitus. And abscess because the swelling is not localized properly. And the thing is that we have to choose between compartment syndrome and cellulitis. So on referring the books, so usually in compartment syndrome, they haven't mentioned anything about the redness. So, and erythema. So in cellulitis, usually all these things are seen. The pain, swelling, redness, and swelling being poorly localized, local tenderness, erythema. So there is a mild thing, mild controversy between compartment syndrome and cellulitis. But what I have referred, the answer looks like cellulitis. So the next question, which one of the following is not associated with BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes? We all know that breast cancer is associated with BRCA1, and we have learned a lot about it. And ovarian cancer, prostate cancer is also associated with BRCA. And liver cancer is not associated with BRCA. So the other cancers which are also associated with BRCA is like colorectal cancers. We also have pancreatic cancers, but not liver cancer. The malignancy associated with Stewart-Trevis syndrome. So this one, you would have seen the picture. This is like a blue color thing or purple color. Purple color in the hand above the swelling. So this is usually occurring on the long-standing lymphedema, that is lymphangiosarcoma. So in long-standing lymphedema, what happens is that after like 10 years or 12 years, this edema gets converted into a angiosarcoma. That is called as lymphangiosarcoma or Stewart-Trevis syndrome. A 60-year-old lady underwent total abdominal hysterectomy. On the third post-op day, she suddenly felt breathless while returning from washroom. Her BP is 80/50, most probable diagnosis. So postural hypotension not possible because she was not suddenly getting up from bed or something. And TIA is also not very unlikely. So the diagnosis for this probably lies between the options B and C. Can be secondary hemorrhage or thromboembolism. Given the fact that she is feeling breathlessness, that is suddenly she is feeling breathless. So this is a symptom of pulmonary embolism, and her BP is also 80 by 50. So in pulmonary embolism, we can also have low BP because due to block, there is no cardiac return of blood. So the cardiac output is less and there can be shock also. The other thing is that it could also be secondary hemorrhage. But secondary hemorrhage, they would have, it's like the breathlessness, the sudden onset of breathlessness, it's unlikely. But a BP of 80 by 50 is definitely pointing out to secondary hemorrhage. But the answer here, given that there is on third post-op day, sudden breathlessness and BP 80 by 50, I would go with thromboembolism. A 52-year-old female underwent MRM. After a few years, she developed lymphedema on the ipsilateral arm. Which one of the following malignancies can develop? We have just discussed it. This is lymphangiosarcoma. That is Stewart-Trevis syndrome. So a gentleman of 60 years old presented with a brawny swelling of the submandibular region with inflammatory edema of the mouth and putrid halitosis. Most likely diagnosis. So brawny swelling is something like a thick swelling with in the submandibular region with inflammatory edema and bad breath. So a tubercular adenitis is usually seen in the cervical region, and these findings are usually not very commonly seen. So brawny swelling, the classical thing we can see is Ludwig's angina. So the Ludwig's angina also causes submandibular region swelling. It is all inflammatory edema of mouth and very bad breath. So the answer to this mostly is Ludwig's angina. A 25-year-old female patient with previous history of neck irradiation presents with thyroid swelling for the last 6 months. Patient is clinically euthyroid. On examination, right lobe of thyroid is enlarged with presence of ipsilateral cervical lymphadenopathy. Most probable clinical diagnosis. So previous history of neck radiation can always mark papillary carcinoma of the thyroid. An infant presents in the surgical OPD with complaints of unilateral swelling of the neck. The swelling was soft, cystic, partially compressible, and brilliantly transluminant. Most probably diagnosis. So among this, only cystic hygroma is brilliantly transluminant and compressible. So we'll go with cystic hygroma, and this is also seen in the infants, which is commonly pointing out towards cystic hygroma. Remember that cystic hygroma is also associated with Turner syndrome. Serum thyroglobulin level is an important tumor marker for papillary thyroid carcinoma. So for medullary thyroid carcinoma, it's calcitonin. So for papillary thyroid carcinoma, it's thyroglobulin. A 43-year-old woman presented with serous discharge from a single duct of nipple in her right breast, which was sent for evaluation. She's likely suffering from. So if the discharge is from single duct, it's intraductal papilloma, for which we do the operation microdeckectomy. But for if it is from multiple ducts, that is commonly ductectasia. So for ductectasia, the common operation done is Hatfield's operation. So here the answer is intraductal papilloma. An eight-month-old male child is brought to the emergency with recurrent episodes of screaming and drawing up of legs. The child appears to be listless in between the attacks. Local examination of the abdomen reveals feeling of emptiness in right iliac fossa. So this is an important point. So there is also blood-stained mucus is found in the finger on per-rectal examination. The probable diagnosis is. So if you see here, local examination of abdomen, there is emptiness is in right iliac fossa. This is called as the sign of Dance, and also blood-stained mucus, that is red currant jelly stools. So these two point out to the diagnosis of acute intussusception. So which one of the following statement regarding Ogliev syndrome is correct? Ogliev syndrome is colonic pseudo obstruction. So presents as acute large bowel mechanical obstruction. No, the name itself says it's pseudo obstruction. So it is not mechanical obstruction. So this is the wrong answer. The other things, marked cecal dilation, common feature on X-ray, true. Cecal perforation is well-recognized complication, true. IV neostigmine is used to treat this condition in order to get the bowel keep going. So the answer for this is 2, 3, and 4. Which one of the following statement regarding carcinoid tumors are correct? Terminal ileum is most common site for these tumors in GIT. These tumors arise from Kulczynski scales. So 5-hydroxytryptamine is the most common peptide. Serum chromogranin A is useful in marker of this disease. So this is a very controversial question, but for surgery, what the paper answers are referred to is from Bailey and Love. So what Bailey and Love says is that appendix is the most common site for these tumors. So in this question, the wrong option is terminal ileum is the most common site. So we'll go with 2, 3, and 4. In familial adenomatous polyposis, which of the following are true? Presence of more than 100 colorectal polyps, it's true. Positive family history, yes. Autosomal recessive, no. That is autosomal dominant condition. So genetic mutation is seen on chromosome 5, it's the APC gene. So in FAP syndrome, that is usually autosomal dominant syndrome. So answer is 1, 2, and 4. A 50-year-old male patient presents to the emergency with sudden onset of upper abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting, hematemesis. On examination, tachycardic and hypotensive, pallor is present. CCT abdomen reveals a large exophytic tumor of the size of 13x8 at the fundus of the stomach. This is important. On upper GI endoscopy, mucosa of the tumor is intact. Staining of CD117. So staining of CD117 of the CMYC staining. So if this staining is positive in upper GI endoscopy and the tumor, if it is very large, the probable clinical diagnosis is gastrointestinal stromal tumors. Which of the following is not a classical symptom of acute appendicitis? So anorexia is seen, periamblical colic. Yeah, the pain usually starts in the periamblical region and then migrates to the right iliac fossa. So that is why this migration of pain is also included in the mantras or the modified Alvarado scoring. Nausea is also seen, but constipation usually not seen. Among the extraintestinal manifestations of Crohn's disease, which one of the following is related to the disease activity? So eye complication, iritis, uveitis is related to the disease activity. Renal calculi, PSC, chronic active hepatitis is not related. Other conditions related is pyoderma gangrenosum. And those kind of conditions is usually related to the disease severity. The modified model for end-stage liver disease, MELD score, includes. So if you think of MELD, remember CBI. CBI is creatinine, bilirubin, and INR. So serum albumin is not included. Which one of the following statement regarding enteric perforation are correct? Salmonella typhi is the causative agent for enteric fever, true. Enteric perforation characteristically occurs during third week of illness. Yes. Typhoid ulcers are placed transversely in the longest. No. Typhoid ulcers are longitudinal. Remember tie. So when you are wearing a shirt, you wear a tie. So that tie is lying longitudinally. So whenever you remember about typhoid, think about longitudinal ulcers. And then the terminal ileum is the most common site for enteric perforation. So only wrong answer is option 3. So correct answer is 1, 2, and 4. A 35-year-old male patient with enteric fever presents to the emergency with sudden onset of generalized abdominal pain, abdominal distension, nausea, vomiting, constipation for the last 48 hours. On examination, she is tachycardic, hypotensive, generalized tenderness, rebound tenderness, board-like rigidity. Board-like rigidity is usually due to peritonitis. So peritonitis commonly occurs due to small bowel perforation in the typhoid fever. So typhoid fever, if you remember the ulcer, just now I said the ulcers are longitudinal. Whenever the ulcers are longitudinal, there is an increase in chance of perforation. So these ulcers commonly cause perforation. So small bowel perforation is the answer for this question. So which one of the following options so used for management of pancreatic pseudocyst? For the pseudocyst management, we either do cystogastrostomy. We connect the cyst to the stomach and let it drain, or we can do percutaneous drainage with the help of pigtail catheter. Endoscopic drainage can also be done, but pancreatic duodectomy, morbid surgery is not required. Which one of the following statements regarding hepatic adenomas are correct? These are commonly almost exclusively seen in females 25 to 50 years, yes. Associated with OCPs, yes. They do not have any malignant potential. No, they actually have malignant potential. So majority are detected incidentally on imaging. Yes, true. The answer is 1, 2, and 4. Which of the following are probable sites for ectopic pancreas? Submucosa of the stomach and duodenum, yes. Liver, yes. Splenic hilum, yes. Small bowel mesentery is wrong here. So I've referred this in the Bailey textbook. They have given it clearly that liver is also included. Submucosa of stomach is included. Splenic hilum is also included. So which of the following statements regarding Cantley's line is correct? So runs between Cantley's line, we all know that runs between the IVC and the gallbladder fossa. But what they have done in this question is that they have just slightly twisted it. Instead of IVC, the correct answer here is it runs between gallbladder fossa and the middle hepatic vein. So middle hepatic vein corresponds to the IVC. Which of the following are indications of splenectomy? So pseudomyxoma peritonei, no. Trauma, yes. ITPS, hypersplenism, yes. A 45-year-old male presents with painless firm abdominal swelling, 10-8 near the umbilicus. Swelling can be moved freely in a plane at the right angle of the line, attachment of the mesentery. So if you see here, this is the Tillox triad that they have tried to mention here. Tillox triad is usually seen in mesenteric cyst. There is a, what this triad says is that there's a swelling near the umbilicus, which can be moved freely. And when you auscultate it, you can hear the tympanic note. The answer is mesenteric cyst. A 45-year-old male patient, a known case of left inguinal hernia, presents to the emergency with an acute onset. So acute onset of pain abdomen with nausea, vomiting, distension. His pulse rate, tachycardic, hypotensive, respiratory rate is 24. Local examination, skin over the swelling is tense, erythematous. Localized tenderness over the swelling. The swelling is irreducible with the absence of cough impulse. Most probable clinical diagnosis here in this patient is strangulated hernia. If you see here, what you can also use a small trick here. The obstructed hernia is also called as incarcerated hernia. So they won't give both. If these things mean the same, they won't give it as a different option. So you can choose the strangulated hernia. Plus, we can also see here that the blood supply has been cut off. So that is why the patient is having this hypotensive and all those signs. So that is probably pointing out to strangulated hernia. Mayo's repair is done for incisional hernia. Mayo's repair is usually done for less than 2 to 3 centimeter hernia, and it also has high recurrence rate. In Pringle's manner, clamping includes CBD, hepatic artery portal vein, and IVC. Generally, we do not clamp IVC because that has severe consequences. So CBD, hepatic artery, and portal vein are compressed or clamped in the Pringle's manner. A patient with suspected head injury is brought to the emergency following RTA. At the time of examination, his GCS is 14 and stable vitals, bleeding from right ear and CSF leak from nose. Bruising is present behind the right ear. So this is pointing out as a battle sign. So battle sign is usually seen in base of skull fracture. Commonest organism causing suppurative otitis media is Streptococcus pneumoniae. So a patient in RTA presents to emergency with increasing restlessness and difficulty in breathing. Respiratory rate is 26, distended neck veins, trachea deviated to the right side. Hyperresonant node and absence of breath sound on the left side. So we all know that it's a left-sided tension pneumothorax. So what do we do in tension pneumothorax is that we do immediate needle decompression. So whenever you suspect a tension pneumothorax, you don't have to do a chest x-ray because while the time you do the chest x-ray, the patient might collapse actually. So instead of, if you have a clinical suspicion, you go for the needle decompression initially and then chest tube should be inserted. So the answer here is 1, 2 and 4 and wrong option is 3. We do not do chest x-ray. PET scan is used in preoperative staging of gastroesophageal tumor to detect. PET scan in the gastroesophageal tumors is usually to detect the occult metastasis. That is, so here the option will be distant metastatic diseases. So which of the following are correct about ectopic ureters? So more common in males, no. They're more common in females. For in fact, that the ratio is 7:1. 7 females is to 1 male. So This answer is wrong. They drain in the upper pole of kidney. Yes. Associated with duplex ureter. Yes. They may cause incontinence. Yes, definitely. Answer is 2, 3, and 4. So now the following agent is nephrotoxic anesthetic agent. Answer is methoxyfluorine. The fluorine compound in this methoxyfluorine is causing severe nephrotoxicity. So this is methoxyfluorine is a very bad agent for the kidneys. A comatose patient sustaining head injury is in the neurosurgical ICU. So the following parameter should ideally be maintained in this patient. So if you see a PaCO2 33 to 38, yes. Mean arterial pressure 89, yes. PaO2 more than 11, yes. Sodium less than 130 more. So usually we don't cause the sodium to be very low. So that too less than 130 is very bad. Less than 140 is preferred. Untidy wounds are characterized by each of the following. Crushed or avulsed, yes. Contaminated, yes. Devitalized, yes. No loss of tissue, no. No loss of tissue, it's not an option. It's usually seen in the tidy wounds. So which of the following statements regarding composition of common crystalline solution is correct? So NS contains 100 milliequivalents of sodium, no, 154. Hartmann solution, that is Ringer lactates, contains 111 milliequivalents of chlorine. Yes, this is the correct answer. NS contains 130 mex of chlorine, no, again 154 mex. RL contains 111 mex of sodium, no, contains 130 milliequivalents of sodium. Perioperative benefit from transfusion with a hemoglobin level of less than 6 grams. If it is less than 6 grams, we can have some benefit. 6 to 8 grams may or may not, but more than 8 grams are not beneficial. So the answer is less than 6 grams. So here we have discussed the questions on surgery. So I hope all of you have got most of it to be correct. So you also can mention how much correct you got out of 40 in the comment section. And also we'll try to solve the other subject questions in the Telegram channel. So the link is given in the description. So kindly join the Telegram channel and help me out in solving these questions so that we can discuss it together. And also, if you find any wrong in these solutions that I have given, so please mention it in the comment section so that I and everyone will know, so no one will be misguided. And don't forget to subscribe. So that's all for this video. I'll soon see you in another video. Thank you.